My name is Kaivan Bilmoria, and I will be actually presenting a small session on Linux kernel debug. So, folks, before we dive into the technical content, a brief introduction from my side. I have been in the industry for a pretty long while, right since the early 90s, 91, 92. And I have worked in few companies and roles, mostly in development. I started working on Linux back in 96, 97, and have pretty much fallen in love with that environment. I continue to work on it. I've been lucky that I have been able to contribute to open source and take part in a small way. I have made a little bit of contribution into the Linux kernel and a few open source projects besides it. I have also, of course, worked on closed source commercial projects. Last year, I brought out this book that you see here, Hands-on System Programming with Linux. And it's been doing pretty well, in fact. Of course, you can go to the local India website. It's available at a much better pricing. This year, I am working on the kernel development book, Linux kernel development. To be honest, it's a bit delayed because there are some changes in the structure. But nevertheless, it will come out this year. So, folks, these things keep me busy. Besides providing corporate training at various companies, I also work on projects when possible and on these books. So, having said that, I think it's fine if we look at a small sample of what I feel you all will experience within a Linux kernel debugging session held by EH. So, guys, on that note, I will just switch over to this virtual machine. It's in fact Fedora 29. And again, I hope the screen is clearly visible to you.
Yes, yes, Kaivan.
Okay, that's great. You can see that in fact it's running a custom kernel. I have compiled a very recent 5.0 Linux kernel on this VM, and in fact in a debug mode so that we get more information from the kernel during runtime, and various checks are in place. Of course, in today's particular session, we are not going in depth into all of the areas because we are just doing this for about an hour's time. So I have chosen one area which I feel is always interesting, namely tracing. So folks, within the broad area known as tracing, there are so many things that the Linux kernel can do to help us debug whether our programs are working in the intended fashion. Because if you think about it for a moment, what really is debugging? It's the process of checking whether the picture in your mind is in line with the picture of memory and the processor on the machine. If there is a deviation between the pictures, then something is not working as you think it is. And identifying that something is basically identifying the bug. Now, easier said than done, of course, as anyone who has worked in a production environment knows. What I try and point out to people working in these environments is that the more you learn about the kernel, its internals, its design, and its implementation, and the more hands-on work you do on it, the better chance you have of understanding what really is going on. In fact, in my personal experience, I find that knowledge of the memory system, the virtual memory system, and how it applies to physical memory is absolutely critical. Again, all these topics will go beyond the scope of a kernel debug course. We do cover these topics in depth in a kernel internals course. Having said that, in today's, you know, to give you a flavor of kernel debug, I'd like to take up tracing. And within tracing, I'd like to focus on two areas. One is a kernel level tool. In fact, it's a framework called ftrace, which is very powerful. Another is a application slash framework built on top of the kernel called LTTNG. LTT is Linux Tracing Toolkit, new generation. Within LTTNG, to help us along, there is a very powerful GUI called Trace Compass. So guys, there are a few things to look at. There is a front end to ftrace called trace command, which is again going to make our lives easier and make it simpler to figure out what's going on our systems in real time. So having said these things, right? What I thought I'll do is I'll dive into these topics. I'll give you a demo of how you can use these things. Once we are through seeing these things, please don't immediately log off. What I'd like to do is give you a flavor of the topics we would cover in the actual course, which of course is much more wide ranging and covers a slew of details. Well beyond this as well, inclusive of this and more. So guys, having said this, let's get started with ftrace. So the obvious question is, what exactly is ftrace? Folks, at the base level, ftrace is a kernel, is a feature baked into the Linux kernel, allowing one, when it's turned on, to trace literally every single function call that the kernel makes, every single API. And you know, when I say that, I don't just mean the system calls. I mean well beyond that, literally every single kernel function. Now, as you can imagine, that's a really powerful feature. That's a really in-depth feature. And sometimes we use ftrace when we are literally out of options and we cannot figure out what's going on. So if we'd like to take a really deep dive into the kernel and look in depth at between time one and time two, what exactly happened inside kernel space, ftrace is a good choice, is a good tool to use at times like this. The other way you can use ftrace is to investigate the system, is to literally learn how user space and the kernel interact and how they work. Of course, ftrace is not user space. There is another interesting way to think of it. The user space closest equivalent is perhaps the strace tool, which I'm sure you all have seen. Strace is a fantastic tool. Why don't we quickly check it out? Guys, if you do ftrace and shall we say ps, just look at the wealth of output. Let's make it a little better. Ftrace writes to standard error, so let's put this into temp. Let's call it ftrace. So we see the output of ps and we have also captured it here. Let's open that with vi. So folks, you can see this. And I think it's fairly obvious by looking at it. We are looking at literally every single system call made by PS. In fact, the even more interesting thing is the first, you know, few dozen system calls that we are seeing is really nothing to do with PS. It's the setup of the C runtime environment, the loading of libraries into the virtual address space of the PS process. That's what's actually going on over here. And you can literally see stuff like this. Let me try and demo something. I searched for libc and I have found it. Here's libc and here it's being opened. This is the return value, the file descriptor number 3. It's being read from, it's being seeked to, and various other operations. But most importantly, you will find it's being memory mapped into the virtual address space of the PS process. And you know, that's how we gain access to the text and data of the C standard library, the standard C library. So folks, you'll find many of these end maps. Anyway, if we scroll further down, you will actually start seeing the work of PS happening. Here's signals being trapped via SIG action. And you will start seeing the proc file system being used, because as many of you will know, PS is nothing but a front end over proc. So guys, we really don't need to go, you know, more in depth into this. This was just to show you that strace is something very powerful, very interesting. If you want to look at the user kernel boundary, then you need to look at the system calls. And strace is a utility that will allow you to do that without any additional compilation, nothing. In fact, strace has been cross-compiled and built for many embedded Linux systems, including Android. Okay. Having shown you this, what I'm really trying to get at is that what if we want to go beyond strace? So folks, we saw that strace is able to show us every single system call that is issued by a process. Now, I think we all understand system calls are really a way to get into the kernel. They are entry points into the Linux kernel. Once you get into the kernel, it's been pretty much a black box. We can't see it. But guys, that's the beauty of ftrace. Ftrace allows us to turn the kernel into a white box. We will literally be able to see everything done by the system calls in the kernel. And as you can imagine, it will be a lot. So, this brings us to the point. I am interested. I want to use ftrace. How do I use it? Okay.
Mother laptop on a beta.
In order to do that.
Just a minute, Kaiwan. Mute yourselves. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah, Kaiwan, please continue. Sorry.
Sure. Okay. No problem, guys. We will continue. Okay. So, in order to use ftrace, what is the prerequisite? That's what I want to look at. So, folks, you remember I told you that ftrace is a kernel feature, which means we need to have a way to turn it on. So it turns out that we have to turn on ftrace as a kernel configuration directive. So to that end, on my laptop, I have the source code of one kernel version. In fact, this happens to be 4.14. Regardless, you can clearly see this is the kernel source tree, guys. A quick way to verify. If I do a head on the makefile, you can see it's 4.14.52. So guys, this is a vanilla Linux kernel downloaded from kernel.org. So let's imagine that we are building a product on an ARM box and the product runs the 4.14 kernel. I want to configure the kernel as part of my work. So here's what I do. Guys, I'm not going into the complete details of this. This is again to give you a flavor. So make arc equals arm minu config is one way to get a UI to look at the kernel configuration and to change it. Okay, it's it's loading up, it's loaded up. So folks, this is a UI. It's a NCurses based interface. Clearly, you can see it's for Linux running on ARM 4.14.52 kernel config. Folks, again, perhaps several of you are familiar with this. This is how we configure the Linux kernel. There are loads and loads of choices. Now, we are talking about ftrace, so I won't, you know, look elsewhere. Let me scroll down. And just as an example, I'm doing this as if for an ARM machine. Let's go to the menu called kernel hacking. Guys, kernel hacking is we are not hacking anything. Well, we are turning on debug features. So let's scroll down. Yes, one quick thing to say. When we release products, we do not turn on debug features. And I think the reason is clear. It increases the memory size and the disk size of the executable or the image file. It even slows down execution in many cases. A very good example would be lock debugging. It's a great boon, but it will slow things down. Sorry. So, you know, what I'm trying to get at is this fact. While you are performing development or maintenance, turning on many kernel debug features and keeping a parallel debug kernel is very important, very critical. And you should run all your test cases against it because it might help you detect bugs. It often does. But
guys, due to some internet connectivity issue, maybe it got disconnected. Be online.
The network, but back online, and hopefully it stays. So I will continue, guys. We are at the kernel hacking menu, and within kernel hacking, the relevant submenu is of course called tracers. So you can see I can toggle this. You can see the asterisk here. That means it's on. If I press the space bar, it goes off. So I'll turn it on again by pressing the spacebar and I will press enter. So now you can see a whole submenu of choices. All these, well, not all, but many of these are to do with ftrace. In fact, look at the very first one, kernel function tracer. This is very much to do with ftrace. I'll press the right arrow and go to the help button over here, press enter. And it's really fairly good. There is a paragraph explaining what this enables you to do. Clearly, as I said earlier, ftrace allows us to trace every single kernel function. That too, in an optimized fashion, a highly optimized fashion. You know, what we're trying to say is, if ftrace is turned off, as it is by default, of course, the overhead is very, very minimal. In fact, it is so minimal that it's not even measurable in micro benchmark. So guys, that's great, which means that even potentially on a production system, you could use X-rays. Not that we usually intend to, but it's possible. Okay, so guys, having seen this, there are several other functions that are related to F-trace, because the reality is actually F-trace is a larger framework. Not only can you trace functions, you can do other interesting things. You can test and determine latency, interrupt latencies, scheduling latencies, hardware latencies. You can do stuff like that with the F-trace framework. So guys, having said this, and now that we can see that it's turned on, I will exit from this menu. Now, in this particular demo session, it is not our intention to, you know, perform a full kernel build, and it's not necessary. So why do I say it's not necessary? Let me show you. I'll switch back to my VM, and I will have a look. Okay. I forgot to say one thing. If we do lsb release minus a, you can see that this is Fedora 29. And I think many of you will be aware, this is the kernel version. And under boot, you will find config files. Actually, let's pick any of them. And let's grep for F-trace. Shall we take 5.0.4? This is a vanilla Fedora release. I just want to show this to you. By default, with most Linux distros, F-trace is on by default, which is very interesting. I'm sure you'll agree. So guys, if F-trace is on by default, then how come we aren't getting tracing happening? Okay, I will explain these things step by step. So guys, what we'll do is, the next thing to figure out, we figured out that F-trace support is available on our kernel. The next thing to figure it is, how do I use it? There must be some kind of UI. Indeed there is. It's a CLI, command line interface. Okay, here's the first thing. We need root access. So let me do that. Let me get myself a root shell. So folks, I just have a shell script that I like to run, which turns on some aliases. But the important point, clearly I'm running as root, okay? So I'm running as root user. The next thing to check, there is another very powerful debug feature in the Linux kernel, which again we cover in depth in the whole course, called DebugFS. DebugFS is a file system. It's a pseudo file system, meaning it lives in RAM. It's not on the disk. Check if it's mounted. Check if it's available. Indeed it is. And again, on pretty much all Linux distros, Ubuntu, Fedora, SUSE, Red Hat, etc., you usually will find it on, and usually the mount point is sys-kernel debug. So guys, this tells us another thing. DebugFS is another prerequisite for using F-trace, and it depends on sysfs, which is another pseudo file system. Okay. The key point, we have verified that DebugFS is mounted over here. So let's cd into that location. Under syskernel debug, you will find several files and folders. These are not files and folders in a typical sense. These are all mounted in RAM. They're all living as a RAM disk. It's a pseudo file system. My next key point, there is required to be a folder called tracing in this subdirectory. Here it is. You see it, right? And this is our UI to F-trace. So guys, we further cd into the directory called tracing. So where are we now? We are in sys kernel debug tracing. And here, if I do an ls, you see several what looks like regular files and a few directories. But I keep reminding you, let's do an ls minus l. Just have a glance at this, guys. All these files are of size zero. That is a clue to us that these are not real files. They are pseudo files, they're in RAM. The owner is always root, the group is always root. It's a similar thing with the folders. They're not on a disk, they're all in RAM. For now, let's not worry too much about all that. What I'll do is I'll do a quick ftrace session. So there are a number of tunables that we can use. So guys, the first thing is, let me check this out. There is a tunable called tracing on. When I cat it, it shows up as zero. In fact, it's quite possible that its initial value is one. If it is one, that means tracing is on. If it is zero, it means tracing is off. On my system, it's off. Next, we do this. We cat a file called current tracer. The value it shows is nop or no op. Nop, of course, means no op. So guys, no op means nothing. It's something like analogous to null. Here's what we do next. There is something called available tracers. We get many values. This depends on kernel config. So folks, do you recollect? I'll go back to the screen. I'll go back to kernel hacking and I'll go back to tracer. And you recollect we saw function tracer, interrupt, scheduling, kernel function graph, etc. Actually, that's what's showing up here. This is the function tracer. This is the function graph one. This is the hardware latencies one. This is block IO and so on. So you can think of this as a plugin. Perhaps the simplest plugin is the function plugin, the kernel function tracer. So let's use it. The current tracer is currently set to no op. So let's change that. Let's make it function. So guys, it's as simple as this. Because I'm running as root, I can do this. I can echo function into current tracer. If I now cat current tracer, it shows up as function. So does that mean that it's now running? No, because it's off. Tracing on has the value zero, which really means that tracing is off. So folks, obviously if I set this value to one, it'll be on. Now, I've not done it in a very methodical manner, but let's just go ahead because I just want to show you some output. So even with having done just this much, let's run a tracing session. So here's what I'll do. Notice that I put a semicolon. Then let's run, shall we say, PS. And then let's do the opposite. Let's echo zero into tracing on, therefore turning it off. So guys, is everyone clear? We are running a quick test case. We are turning on ftrace with the function tracer, the kernel function tracer plugin. We are just running one binary executable, which will become a process, PS. And then we are turning tracing off. After that, our intention is to look at the report. So let's run it. Fair enough, guys. So I press enter. And you notice there's a delay because all the machinery is running. And don't forget, we're on a VM. So it runs. PS run. And by now, tracing has been turned off. So the question I'm sure is, where is the result? So guys, the answer to that, the result is inside this file called trace. So let's check it out. If I do ls minus l on trace, it shows me byte size zero, which obviously means it's not there. Well, it's a pseudo file, folks. Don't get fooled by this. Here's what we typically do. We copy trace into some temporary file, shall we say, temp trace.txt. In fact, I have an older version. Let's just overwrite it. Now I do an ls on that file. And guys, look at the output. It's over 5 megabytes. We just traced PS, but the output report is over 5 MB. That's pretty large. Next thing to say, and very important to understand, the kernel traced everything that ran in kernel space at that time. You know what I'm talking about? At this time, between the tracing being turned on and being turned off, it's not just PS that ran. So many other things must have run in the background. So without further ado, let's look up the report. So guys, here it is. Now, this doesn't look very inspiring, but it works. It's very big. There are 149,000 odd lines. The function worker thread called the function process one work. Process one work called this function. This function called this function, and so on. All the functions that were called during that, you know, second or two when tracing was on. It's huge and it's not very readable. Let's come out of this file and let's do this whole thing again, but let's improve it. So how shall we improve it? See, folks, you remember that I set current tracer to function. I'm going to do Control C and I'm going to do this again. Instead of setting it to function, I'm going to use something much superior. I'm going to use function graph. So we do this. By the way, if you make a mistake, it won't accept it. You have to give it, it has a validity check. You have to give a valid option. Only then will it accept it. Okay, that's great. Having done this, let's run our test case again. So guys, I will recall what we did earlier. I will press enter. This time PS will run under the auspices of the function graph tracer. So it's running. We should see the output of PS soon. Looks like it's under some load on my virtual machine. Okay, so it's done. Folks, same procedure. Copy trace onto temp trace.txt, overwrite it. Let's do ls minus lh. This time it's a little over 3 MB. Let's look at the report with VI. All right, isn't it much more readable? It's far more human readable because of the function graph. It literally gets us a call graph. So guys, this time we get indentation, we get braces. You can literally see which function is calling what. So folks, this itself is pretty amazing. However, even though this is nice, it's still lacking in a lot of detail. And to help us get those details, here's what I've done. I'm going to switch to another window on my terminal. I wrote a shell script, folks. I wrote a shell script called ftraceanycommand.sh. It's just a simple shell script. Here it is in gvim, okay? So guys, we can make all this available to you after this session. Don't worry about it. I have a function called reset ftrace and a function called init ftrace, and obviously these perform the reset and the initialization. So folks, these are the details which we go into in the full course. I'm turning on an option called latency format. I'm turning on an option called context info and so on. I'm setting a buffer size to 20 megabytes because this is in kilobytes. I'm doing stuff like that. Here are some validity checks. I'm checking I'm running as root, checking for ftrace support, the debug FS file system being mounted. And most important, let me just scroll to that. Line number 82. This is where we're actually performing the trace. And guys, over here, it's been hard coded to use the function graph, the call graph tracer. Okay. So why don't we run the shell script? There's another value add that I've done. Actually, this doesn't always work very well. We attempt an egret looking for just the program of interest, actually more like the process of interest. So anyway, folks, having shown you that there is such a shell script, why don't I just try and run it? So guys, the first thing we should notice, give it a moment. Clearly, we need to run it as root. So let's do that. We sudo it, of course. Okay, so I type in my password. It's checking for ftrace support. It finds it's fine. It finds that this is the location which concurs with what we saw earlier. And now it shows the usage screen. So, you know, this is an example. We can run it like this. So why don't we try it out? Let's do something, you know, exactly like it's shown over here. Let's do PS minus LA. In fact, maybe you're aware, with the capital L, we'll see every thread, not just every process. So guys, let's try it out. I press enter. It's initializing the ftrace subsystem. And soon it will actually run the process. And ftrace, under the hood, ftrace has been turned on. So again, guys, it's you know, it's pretty slow on my virtual machine, but nevertheless, it's running. So yeah, it's really slow, but that's okay. We're just interested in debug techniques, not in performance issues. So you know, there's a whole bunch of threads that's alive on the operating system. And under the hood, the trace report will be generated. Of course, our shell script will do it. So folks, it really is slow, but we shall forgive it. Let it run to completion. Okay, it's probably nearing completion. Yes, it's now copying the full tracing report into temptrace.txt. And you know, the fact is it's really going to be pretty large. So it's taking more time. Because if you recall, we turned on other options called latency options, context info. Context info is very interesting. It will show us which process or thread is running which function in the kernel. Guys, a fundamental fact of the Linux kernel is that it's monolithic in design. What does that mean? It means that when a process or a thread issues a system call, that process or thread switches into kernel mode and runs the code of the system call in the kernel. It's not the kernel running, it's that process. Okay, so guys, we've got a report, but what did I tell you? It's simply enormous. It's 74 megabytes. Can you believe it? And folks, this is in a sense the downside of performing tracing. The report files are so huge that to comb through it can get difficult. So, you know, when we cover further details in the full-fledged course, I will show you in detail how you can filter the output, how we can say things like, don't show me these functions, do show me these functions. We can do stuff like that. In any case, now as a demo, I'm just opening the entire file. But just look at it, guys. This time, the output is a lot more interesting. Okay, I've gone to line number one, and let me tell you how to read it. The first column is the CPU on which the thread ran. So it ran on CPU zero. My virtual machine has two CPUs, zero and one. This is the task. This is the thread that ran. In fact, by the way, this is a kernel thread. These fields I will explain in a moment. This is the duration it took for this function. So it took in the region of 6 odd milliseconds. It's amazing. You can literally see 1.1 microseconds for the spin lock code. So guys, now we are really seeing details. This kernel thread ran this code. You can see how long it took. It's really amazing. If you all are familiar with the Linux kernel and some of its internals, you will know that this code is how scheduling is done. This is called CFS code, completely fair scheduling. This is CFS in action. It's actually picking the next task to run. So let me scroll down a bit. This is the context switch. Do you see it? This thread has switched to this thread. This is its PID, 27031. And now this thread is run and it's executing this code within the kernel. So guys, this is what ftrace can show us in great detail. So that's interesting, right? And it goes on and on and on. Let's perform one more experiment as something fun to do, guys. If I'm not mistaken, I have a highly complicated, okay, it's not there. I made a mistake. A highly complex C program over here. I'm joking, of course. This is the classic Hello World. So guys, check this out. Let's compile it. Let's create a binary executable called, why don't we call it hello? We ignore the warning. If we run hello, it works, of course. But now see what I do. Can you guess? Let's ftrace it. So guys, we're ftracing hello world. Exactly what we did earlier under the same shell script. It's just that this time it's hello world that's running. So folks, it's run quicker than that ps command ran. That's great. The report is being generated. So again, the report might be pretty large. It's taking a while. If you can see this icon over here, the virtual disk is pretty busy. Okay, the report is large. It's 69 megabytes. Nevertheless, we shall, whoops, /temp/trace.txt. We shall open it. Okay, guys, it's interesting. It's not exclusive. There were various other tasks running at the time that Hello World ran. All of them show up, like, you know, this LLVM guy, and so many others. If I keep scrolling down, you'll see. This is the kernel swapper daemon. It's a housekeeping thread within the kernel. If I scroll up a bit, you can see the context switch between the drag and drop thread and the kernel swapper daemon. Anyway, we aren't interested in all these guys. Let's search for hello. So folks, interesting, right? Our hello world process ran on CPU 0. Okay, here it is. Now, ftrace is really powerful, guys. Do you see this arrow pointing to the left? That means we have ended a context switch, probably an interrupt. An interrupt has completed. In fact, you can see over here the IRQ exit. So a right arrow denotes a hardware interrupt. You will probably find it scattered in this output. Guys, when we do the whole course, I will explain how we can filter in a much better fashion. Let me just do one experiment. Do you see this? This is a hardware interrupt occurring. In fact, it's the timer interrupt. The timer interrupt fires hertz times a second, depending on the value of config hertz, usually something like 250 or 350. Guys, what do these columns mean? The first column, if it's a dot, that means you're running in process context. If it's a D, that means interrupts are disabled. Right now, interrupts are disabled because when a hardware IRQ runs, all other interrupts are disabled. The second column, if it's a dot, it means it's the normal case. If it is capital N, and here's an example. Do you see it over here? If it is capital N, the kernel's need underscore resced flag has been set. Shall I just write that down so that it's called TIF need resced. If this flag is set, it means the kernel is saying I need to reschedule ASAP. I need something else to run. So that's what it's saying over here. So that means this LLVM pipe thread has finished and someone else must run. Anyway, the third column, if it's a dot, it's the normal case. The other values it can take is H or S. Here's an example of H. H means hardware interrupt. This code is running in the context of a hardware interrupt. That's what it means. S means soft IRQ, not software interrupt, soft IRQ. It's called bottom half processing. The last column, if it's a dot, it's the normal case. If it's a positive number, it means a lock has been taken. It's called preemption count. It's the number of nested locks that has been taken. So guys, this is all precious information when you are debugging. So let's again search for hello, and you can see hello executing its code. Now guys, you will know we did printf hello world. How does it work? It works by printf issuing the write system call. Inside the Linux kernel, here's another fact. As a general thumb rule, any system call foo, when it crosses the boundary into kernel space, it usually becomes the function sysfoo. And very often, but not always, that becomes the function dofoo. So guys, this is an interesting thing to know. As a matter of fact, the write system call will become sys underscore write or a close equivalent, but it does not become do write. It becomes in fact the VFS write. I can actually show you these things. But on the other hand, if you take fork or if you take, take fork. Fork becomes sys underscore fork, which becomes do underscore fork. Let's come back. Let's come back to our report and let's search for sys underscore write. So guys, I have found it. It's become double underscore x64 sys write. However, this is under another thread, so we aren't interested. Let's look for this under the write. We could always do a grep. Here it is. We found it, guys. So do you understand? here's where the hello process issued a write system call. So that's very interesting. The write became VSS write. That's very interesting. Let's scroll down. The VFS write became TTY write. Guys, does it make sense? We are writing to the terminal device. We are writing to a device file, not to a regular file. In fact, this is where driver level code will next take over. So you can keep following it. The TTY write will become other code. Now it's confusing because we are interleaved with so many other threads. We could always do a grep, or we could ask ftrace itself to filter out others. So folks, this is what I wanted to show you. You know, these are the TTY calls that happen. And similarly, you will find a lot more of this stuff. Okay, the low level details of the write system call. Here it is. Mutex locks are being taken. Check this out. This looks like the low level call to output a character onto the TTY device. You know, the H-E-L-L-O, etc. This is where it's occurring. It becomes PTY write, TTY insert, etc., etc. So check out the level of detail that we can get to see. Every single function, including driver code. All code running in kernel space. That's what ftrace can do. Guys, I'll stop it here because, you know, we don't have too much time. And I'd like to show you all other things. There is a much easier way to do it. There is a front end to ftrace called trace command. If I run trace command, you have to install it. You will get various options. Let me just do a quick demo. Let's do trace command. Let's sudo it so that it runs with root permission. We set up a recording session. Let's record. Sorry, I forgot something important. I use the switch minus F, capital F, to mean exclusively record only what this process does inside the kernel. So that's very powerful. Much better than ftrace, right? Where we saw a lot of clutter, a lot of noise. It will filter out everything else. We will only record the work that Hello World does inside the kernel. So guys, let's run this. I made a mistake. We have to specify what plugin to use. Let's switch to another shell. Let's do man trace command record to get help. And this is the syntax, minus p tracer. All right. So we come back here and I do minus p function graph, because that's the tracer I want to use. Okay guys, looks like I'm making some syntax mistake. It's function underscore graph. Okay, fair enough. Let's fix our mistake. Let's run it. Now it looks like it's working. It will capture data. Okay, it records data on a per CPU basis. So, you know, it has done that and the output goes into a file called trace.dat. So you can see it's fairly large. This is a binary file. Interpret it using trace command report trace.dat. So guys, check this out. Here's the report. Now that's hard to read. So of course, what we usually do is we write this into a file. Let's call it report.txt. So there we are. Now we have a report. In function graph format, you can see the call chain. You can see the duration of each of these functions. You can see who executed it, the process context. You can see it's the Hello World app. So folks, this is pretty amazing, yeah? In fact, it's wrapping around. You can see that, but that's okay. And you can study this in depth. Again, it's very large. We can search for sys underscore write. Okay, that I don't think it's in that exact same format. Anyway, it will be found if we take the trouble. So folks, that's a quick demo of trace command. To help you along, I wrote a shell script which makes it a lot easier. So this is a helper shell script, and it makes things easier. For example, during the reporting, right, it uses some special switches so that we leave out interrupt information. Pretty often we are not interested in that. So you could run the shell script and, you know, we'll make this stuff available to you. You could run the shell script and it will be simpler. So guys, why don't we do the same experiment using the shell script? So it's done it. The report will be generated. Okay. The report has come into this file. Let's check it out. So here we are. Again, very detailed. And this time we've left out any interrupt code so as to not get sidetracked with those details. But all the other details are visible to you, which is very powerful. Okay guys, since I don't have much time, let me show you the next thing on the agenda. I hope you don't mind, we're slightly spilt over. But this is really interesting. There is this really powerful tool called LTTNG. Folks, if you just Google it, you will find a very good website with detailed documentation. This is a very well-known tool, years and years, free and open source. It's very powerful. The documentation is excellent. And I have seen this in production use by many companies. They use it to identify bottlenecks and to help debug tricky situations. So what do we do with LTTNG? Let's come back here. First of all, you have to install it. I'm not going into the installation procedure, but once you do install it, a lot of kernel modules will, okay, I think over here it's not been installed, but once you do install it, there'll be a lot of kernel modules. Guys, I think I made a mistake. I think it's in my native laptop. I think it's installed over there. Shall I just rerun this? Yes, just check it out. These are all kernel modules with regard to LTTNG. There are lots of them. Okay, now that we know it's there, how do we use it? So folks, again, to make things easy for you, allow me to just switch to the correct folder where I have my source code. Kernel debug tracing LTTNG. I wrote a shell script. So folks, in the interests of seeing something, let me just run it for you. When you run LTTNG, we'll get it to trace everything that's going on in the kernel. There is also a way to trace what's going on in user space. But that is more complex. You have to annotate your code. So we aren't going into that aspect. To get kernel events, you need the kernel modules installed. And as you saw, this is my Ubuntu box. It is installed. So what we'll do is, the shell script wants a session name. Let's just say test one. And if I pass a zero as the second parameter, you know, over here, these things are written. It will trace everything that's going on in the kernel. Let's just try it out. Okay, it's running. Folks, this is the work of the shell script. It's created a session. LTTNG is running. Tracing has begun And whatever is going on in the kernel right now is being traced. So, you know, I can go and click on something, and I can go and visit some website, you know. So all this ultimately results in some socket code, something. Now I press enter and it ends the tracing session. It performs a cleanup. And as a matter of fact, I tar the files so that you have it saved. Okay, why am I saving the output files? Because they're in binary. Now, LTTNG provides CLI tools to look up the results of the trace. To be honest, it's difficult to interpret the results from the CLI tools. It's called Babel trace, B-A-B-E-L. Now, you could Google it and you could read and learn how to use Babel trace. But the fact is, there's a much better way. There is an amazing GUI program which is pretty analogous to the Eclipse project. It's called Trace Compass. We'll use Trace Compass. So guys, I'm running Trace Compass. Hang on a sec. I need this. I need to verify that this output has been generated. You can see that this is where it's been generated. So let's switch to another terminal window and just check. Yes, it has been generated. So folks, this is all the binary output data here. This is where I must point Trace Compass. So let me do that. In Trace Compass, I'll go to the menu, File, Open Trace. And within this, I will go to Temp and today's trace, kernel, and I'll click on OK. That's all you have to do. Again, click on OK. It will parse the details. So guys, it has parsed the details and it is generating the graph. So folks, isn't this amazing? Every process alive on the system is shown. And these colors, this is a timeline, and it's, you can zoom into the level of microseconds, if not nanoseconds. You have an amazing timeline over here. And you can do stuff like this. Okay, the CPU usage is very high. I'm loading the system. But just check this out, folks. This is a, you know, professional quality tooling. For example, the process of interesting your application, the one that you're interested in. Just as an example, what if we click on LTTNG itself, the LTTNG client, and then click OK? Then everything else gets filtered out and only LTTNG shows up. Now I click anywhere on the timeline and I click the right arrow. It goes over here. If I keep the mouse there, let's zoom in. So guys, now it starts to get interesting. Okay. I lost it. Let me go there again. And you know, folks, it's so kernel level code that ran and its parameters, which is amazing. So folks, this is fantastic for debug. A kmalloc has been done. This is the pointer, and it asks for 64 bytes. These are the GFP flags, the GFP bitmap. Okay, this is taking time. But I hope you're seeing the power of this. It's very powerful. You can okay. It's just that it's a bit slow. So guys, check it out. The blue color is system call. You can clearly see an ioctl has been issued by process EMT0. You know, folks, this is what VirtualBox uses. It's one of its processes. So it's issued an ioctl system call, okay? And if you click on the timeline, this will update to show you what call you're on. Then I can press right arrow to proceed to the next event. The green color is user space, user mode code. We can't see what the code is, but we know it's user mode. Again, it's an ioctl system call. And folks, you can see in the kernel, this is the ioctl. Coming back here, right arrow. Okay, so do you see this yellow color? It's blocking on an event. The darker brown represents another state, I recall correctly. That's the darker brown color. So, you know, you can zoom in further and you can see all that stuff. So guys, you can literally trace the execution. This pinkish or purplish color is a hardware interrupt. Check it out. Here we're in a hardware interrupt. In fact, you can see the code. It's a soft IRP. Okay. So guys, you can use trace compass and you can literally identify bottlenecks and you can debug what's going on at the level of the kernel in a graphical format. So folks, I know we're over the time. These are the things that I wanted to show you in this brief session. And in the actual course, we of course go into more detail. Let me just switch back. This is what I told you at the beginning of the session. These are the things I tried to show you. Ftrace, trace command, LTTNG, trace compass. And of course, it's not been very, very in-depth because we don't have the time, but you saw a little about it. Folks, one last thing. This is the kind of content typically covered in a kernel debug course. It's really pretty detailed, and I think you will find there's a lot of value. You know, even the humble printk is very, very powerful. Debugging by instrument limiting, you can use Mac. I have a header file which makes things easier. I show how to use debugfs in detail, writing API level code, how to debug with the ioctl. Today we saw the ftrace, but of course there are more details here. We saw a little bit of LTTNG and trace compass. Perf tools is another thing which I haven't shown in this session. And here are many more details, folks, that we go into in the detailed course. How to interpret an oops, what exactly is an oops, how do we generate one, how do we interpret one. I often use the ARM and an ARM board like a Raspberry Pi as a live, you know, example, so that it's more hands-on and interesting. And I show how you can interpret these things. I show how you can help debug system hang, kernel panics. Watchdog timers and how they help. GDB for kernel space. KGDB, how do we use it within the kernel? Kernel GDB in depth, and a demo session using the kernel emulator, sorry, the system emulator called Qemu along with KGDB. And I use this on an ARM session. K-probes, J-probes, these are all very useful, very powerful tools. In fact, SystemTap is a wrapper over KDump and Crash are really powerful tools to help you debug things when crashes occur in the field. And, you know, there is no clue as to what really went wrong on a production box. So, you know, RHEL and SLAT, they use these by default nowadays. And the developer sent a dump image, a kernel dump image, something like the equivalent of a code dump in user space. And that's the kdump facility. It generates the image file. But how do we analyze the image? By using a very powerful app called Crash. Crash is kind of like a superset of GDB. And it can do some really amazing things. So folks, I'll stop here. I know we've gone over the time that was allotted. Sorry about that. But I hope it's been interesting and useful for you all. You could even ask questions or email questions to us, which I'll be happy to respond to. We'll also make the scripts that I showed you, we'll make it available to you, so that you can try things on your own. I hope you'll consider signing up for the full-fledged session. I think it's a lot of value.